actually there are two different types of structure. So you can put it this way, so these are between two little fingers, or you can put it this way, between two thumbs. And we can see that these two kind of domain walls have different geometry just by this simple control. So we call this domain wall up down, domain wall down up. But what do this tell us? So in a very extreme case, if one of the domain wall has a very high energy compared to the other, that means the one with higher energy will not appear in real materials. So only the one with lower energy appears, and when we consider the threefold symmetry, we see this triangular shaped domains. And in another extreme case, if this material is not chiral, then this two wall will be exactly the same and has the same energy. That's why we see a equilateral hexagon in lithium metal bit. And then we want to study the magnetic property of this kind of new materials. So in these materials, first they can be a ferroelectric candidate, and also we can include magnetic ions on it, and it's compatible with ferroelectricity. So here we study, so here I show a structure with a polarization up, and we study a simple magnetic order, which we call it UDU, which is up, down, up on A1, A2, and the B cation, and the B prime is non-magnetic. So this is a very simple magnetic ordering. We didn't consider any non-collinear or spiral. But in this simple case, we have a ferry magnetic order, which is up. And now when we have a ferry electric domain, what do we have? So here I have another structure with polarization down. And when we put the magnetic ordering, actually we have two choices. So in this case, the magnetic ordering is the same as this domain. So it's also A1 is up, A2 is down, and B is up. So it's UDU. But we can also put this one. So this one also has minus P structure, but the magnetic ordering is get reversed. So we have down, up, down on all these spins. So for if we only compare the energy of the bulk between these two, they have exactly the same energy because of the time reversal symmetry. But when they form domain walls, the symmetry is lower. So those two, the domain wall between these two and these two, may have different energy. And that's what we calculate. So we studied a model system, this Magni-3 constant 06, with this magnetic ordering. And we find that this case actually is favored in energy. But what does this tell us? So we have a domain wall between plus P plus M and minus P minus M. So here we have both the ferroelectric domain and magnetic domain, and the domain wall is also between them. And if we apply an electric field to switch the polarization, because of what we find, the magnetization will also be get reversed. So we think this is a domain wall mediated, a very strong magneto-electric coupling. At last, we also can calculate the ferroelectric reversal through the domain wall motion. So we want to. So we only do first principle calculations for supercells, and this kind of a cartoon shows how we calculate a domain wall reversal. So we have a supercell with an up domain, down domain, and by using structure constraint, we'll flip the polarization at the domain wall from down gradually to up. So in that, so that we can move this domain wall one step to the right. And this structural constraint is achieved by defining the distance between this mobile A cation, the distance between A and the oxygen plane as C1 and C2, and then we use this C1 plus C2 is our structure constraint. And here is what we found for the energy profile. So minus 1 is the structure with polarization down, and up is the polarization up structure. And along the path, we got two peaks, and for each of these peaks, they correspond to the structure. When one of the A cation migrate from this up octahedral to the down octahedral. This is the barrier structure. And this is a summary of the energy. images we got from the domain world reversal calculations. So we have this in Alembic, this in Tantalum, and we also find some materials that has barriers even smaller than this lithium niobate and lithium tantalum. And in addition, we also try to find some empirical rules to explain the calculated value here. So here we borrow the concept from chemists, the bond valence, the bond valence sum. So here the bond valence is an empirical formula. It has this R naught and B are all empirical parameters. And Ri is the distance from the central, for example, A tie to the oxygen. And this bond valence sum describes the bonding environment of the A tie in the oxygen of the hydrogen. And now we plot the energy, the domain wall barrier energy, versus the bond valence sum. And it's shown here. So we can see that there is pretty good linear correlation between the domain wall mediated reversal barrier and the normalized bound valence sum. So this actually gives us a very intuitive picture. So when the bound valence sum is small, that means this, from a chemical point of view, that means the A cation is loosely bonded to the oxygen tetrahedral. So that's why this A cation can be easily migrate between the octahedrons. That's why it has a smaller barrier. And at last, here's the summary. So we studied the structure, polarization, magnetization, and chirality of the domain wall of this in this current derivatives. And we find a possible domain wall mediated mechanisms for strong magnetoelectric response. And we find this bond valence sum can be used to estimate the domain wall reversal barrier. And for more more details can be found in our recent papers. And thank you for your attention.
Questions? So has anyone observed this experimentally for the manganese tungstate, for example?
So in that case, you mean only for the polarization or also the magnetization?
Right.
So there are efforts that trying to observe the, first about the ferroelectricity, they have some effort trying to observe that. And but for the magnetization, I have to say that the real magnetic ordering probably is more complicated than this. So we said this is a kind of a model system. But we think, although in this material, magnet 3 times in O6, this is not the true magnetic ground state. But that doesn't rule out there are other possible proton derivatives that can have very magnetic ordering and can have this kind of coupling.
Do you need green batteries? Because single crystal lithium niobate
you see in lithium niobate,
you had that as one of your materials that follow this order.
So what's the question?
You have magnetoelectric properties observed in lithium niobate.
Have or have not? No, there's no magnetic cation there. But we calculate lithium niobate because it's a ferroelectric, so we would like to use that as a standard.
All right. One last question, and then we'll move on.
Do you think that this correlation between domain wall energy and the valence bond sum would work in other materials which have A-side polarization, like denuclearized or lead-based electrodes?
Would
it scale the energy of the bismuth ferrite?
So I would say, so in this case, the reason we use like the bond valence sum of A cation, not the B cation, or any other things, is because from previous study of lithium niobate, we know that this lithium cations need to move between this octahedral, which kind of seems like a very large displacement. So, and related to the bonding. But if it's like cross guide, if it's only a small off-center shift, I think this doesn't work.
All right, let's thank our speaker one more time. Our speaker is Wei-Da Wu from Rutgers University, and he's going to tell us how we actually image these magnetoelectric domains. So, Wei-Da?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, William, for the introduction, and also thanks to the organizer for inviting me. It's my great pleasure to attend this workshop. I really learned a lot from this very nice workshop. So today I'm going to talk about our recent efforts trying to develop a new microscopy technique to directly visualize the magnetoelectric domain. Namely, we try to probe magnetoelectric response at local scale. So, as sort of illustrated in this cartoon, is that the way we realize this kind of imaging mode is to utilize magnetic force microscopy, or MFM, and to probe electric field-induced magnetic signal at local scale. Okay. So, most of this talk we'll be talking about so-called hexagonal magnetite materials, and we have some success on these materials. And if you time allow at the end of the talk, I'll also try to talk about recent effort trying to use this technique to look at hexagonal ferrite, which has been a recent interest, right? And there's a favorite talk yesterday about hexagonal ferrite. And this work is supported by DOE, the Career Award. So first, I'd like to thank my collaborators, single crystal hexagonite from my colleague St. John's group, very nice high quality single crystal, and we have been very benefit from a great collaboration with series, Maximus Towell and Craig Finney from Cornell, and also our hexagonal ferrite thin film is from Dr. Shalom's group. And I'd also like to especially thank my former student, Yan-Han Gang, who did all the wonderful imaging work. And some recent ferrite work was done by my current student, Lungo Wang. Okay, so I think I don't need to introduce too much about magnetoelectric effect. I think many of you are interested in how to realize giant magnetoelectric effect, which have potential technology applications. So, as I just mentioned, I'd like just mention that magnetoelectric effect, especially the linear magnetoelectric effect, can be found in material with broken emission symmetry and broken time reversal symmetry. And such it manifest as the electric field induced magnetic agents, or through the same tensor, it can use magnetic field to induce polarizations. So, it's typically how people measure the microscopic response. Okay, so you first use the so-called ME, polling the sample to realize a single domain state, just like you try to magnetize the magnet to produce a single domain state. And then you put your sample, attach electrolytes and put it into a script, for example, and then apply using electrode to apply high electric field to induce magnetization, and then to use a magnetometer, here the script, to measure the induced magnetization. So that's how people typically measure ME response. The bulk response. So for this kind of a measurement, you have to rely on, you can realize single domain state. And as we know, not every multivariate or multivariate material can be realized single domain state, pinning or leakage. Right? And also, more importantly, as far as I know, any domain has not been directly, namely, using this response to probe the domain structure. There's been earlier work using optics and linear optics to visualize the domain, but those are not using the magnetoelectric response to probe the domain. Okay. So that's our motivation to develop a technique that will probe it in local scale. And so so the technique we use is coming from magnetic force microscopy and from magnetic imaging committee. So MFM is basically having, is a, attached a small magnet, basically you deposit some zinc film on these cantilever tips, and then this becomes a small moment, interact with the domain, the street view from the domain from the sample, and that lead to a, basically dipole-dipole induction lead to the change of the resonant frequency to the dipole inductions. Okay? So that's a typical how you do MFM. And now if you attach a lead to the sample, okay, to apply electric field, and if the sample is magnetoelectric, then especially if the sample has different magnetoelectrics on the domain, across the domain boundary, then the induced magnetic field will again interact with this little moment, will be detected by the MFM. So that's the basic principle. And of course, to realize that this is, we know the magnetic response typically is very tiny, and when you apply very large electric field, induced moment usually typically much smaller than what you can detect from the ferromagnet. So in order to enhance the signal noise ratio, we use modulation techniques. So basically we apply AC voltage and modulate the electric field, and the response will be modulating at same frequency, and that will be detected by the MFM. So this frequency will be modulated, and then you demodulate twice, and then you get the ME response. So that's the simple idea how this works. Okay, so to realize that we implant this scheme into our homemade variable temperature MFM, so we have this homemade MFM, this cross approach and sample stage, and we can put into an 8 slot certainly magnet, so we can apply high magnetic field and change the temperature pretty much from 3 Kelvin to room temperature. And also, we have a reasonably sensitive resolution, spatial resolution, order of 20 to 50 nanometer. And we have a high sensitivity, and in this case, because we perform the measurement in high vacuum, so the high quality factor, and we can detect a very tiny, even tiny moment, so many of the multiple particles have a bit. And more importantly, we spent some effort to introduce high voltage leads so that we can apply a feature order of a kilovolt to realize this MEFM. And of course, we also have leads to do in situ transport, but that's for something else. Okay. So so the system we chose to test the performance of this MEFM is so called hexagonal magnetite, in particular erbium magnetite. Okay. The reason we chose this system is that we have a very nice, interesting phase diagram shown here. We have a temperature magnetic field phase diagram. If you don't apply magnetic field and zero magnetic field, when you cool down below the Nell-Oden temperature, it forms this particular ordering, having so called B2 symmetry, which is non, doesn't allow diagonal magnetic response. On the other hand, when you apply small magnetic field, not too small, Tesla or magnetic field, you can drive the system through spin rotation transition to some of the A2 phase. So that was been discussed in yesterday a lot about this A2 phase, which allow magnetic response. So we can use magnetic field to switch to turn on and off the magnetic response, and then to see whether we can detect this magnetic response from the system. Okay. So, so since yesterday there's several talks on hexagonal ferrite, so I don't need to introduce much about the background of the hexagonal system. So multi-ferric hexagonal magnetite and also ferrite have this kind of a layer structure, and this system is undergoing unstable undergo this sort of chimerization mode, buckling of the magnetic structure cage, which break immersion symmetry and therefore induce polarization along the C-axis. This is illustrated here. And now if it's a magnets or ions, they are also magnetic. So if there's a no chimerization, this is a fractured system, as we mentioned yesterday. So the chimerization mode also partially leaves the fractured so that it allows the system to order at low temperature. And therefore, I would like to emphasize here that this chimerization mode behave basically provide a great bridge between the polar or charge ordering and the spin, which is magnetic ordering, which is actually the how we can realize magnetic coupling in this material. Okay, So also, this coupling between the chimerization mode and the polarization mode actually lead to a very interesting ground state configurations. We have this kind of a fixed n-type, so-called n-type phase, and ferrous domain structure, a fixed ground state, basically like a six-day clock model. So therefore, it leads to this six-day topological defect formation in this interesting materials. So there's a lot of related work been done. But here, we're just utilize the fact that pretty much this vortex form very high temperature when this chimerization mode condensed. So at room temperature below, this kind of topological vortex are pretty much fixed, this domain state is fixed. And now when we cool down at low temperature, we apply electric field, they won't move, and we will detect the NE response from individual protein. Okay. So that's how we started the experiment. So firstly, at room temperature, use a sort of PFM, phase response, phosphate phosphate to visualize this vortex topological defect domain. And then you deposit contact on top, okay, and put it to the MFM, put that at room temperature, find the same locations. And now at 4 Kelvin, we apply modulation electric field, and we don't see anything, which is nice, consistent with expectations. And now we turn on magnetic field, the drive system into the A2 phase, and then we see a very pronounced signal. Okay? And interestingly, this response actually is actually at the same domain pattern as the fresh domain structure. So that indicating the sign of the magnetic response change across the fresh domain boundary. Okay? So why so? It works. Okay? Before I explain why this is the case, let me just explain that we did a lot of control measure to make sure this will be a measure is really magnetic response from the sample, not from other artifact or crosstalk. Okay, so for example, we make sure this is a linear response. It's a signal linear increase in the applied electric field, and it's independent of the modulation frequency. And also, we put in different sample with different domain state, observe the same phenomenon, even sample without vortex domain, abstract domain. And also in related material, ytterbium magnetite also observe the same behavior. And in a different magnetic material, disposing iron oxide, we observe the magnetic response from our MEFM. So, and then of course, we have control on the non-magnetic material which have no response. Okay, so we make sure this is really from the set, not from some other effect. Okay. So now let me try to explain why this ME response changing sign across the fresh domain boundary. So in this A2 phase, as you will know, now the spin is pulling out from the triangle. Okay. Now, so because of the as I already explained yesterday, because of the buckling of the main oxygen cage, through the DM interactions, the spin is no longer strictly in the plane, it's still tending up a little bit, so that this is a big ferromagnetic phase. Okay, it's a small tending moment. Now, if you apply electric field to promote the, to enhance the ferroelectric property, then if you enhance the chimerization mode, then of course you will tend the moment more. That's why you apply the electric field, and then the moment increases slightly, and of course, if you apply opposite electric field, the moment will reduce, because you sort of try to undo this buckling a little bit. So now this will be the linear magnetic response of this material through the chimerization mode. Okay. So of course, our collaborative simulation analysis to make sure this is the case. So roughly, in a nutshell, the magnetic response, the sign, is proportional to the sign of the tending moment sign and the polarization. Okay? And therefore, since this, when you do the measurement, is in a Hamming field, so all the tending moments are aligned. So in other words, this is a fixed sign, and therefore the sign of the magnetic response is determined by the sign of the fresh polarization or the P. Okay? So that's explanations. Okay, So this is just quantitative behavior, but the detail is the way the our collaborator Pat Finney also calculate the theoretical response into very tiny, about 1 picometer. Okay. So so we try to be more quantitative. And now we're looking at more the whole true dependence. Then it's much more complicated than the simple picture that I just described, just on and off. So this what is showing here is, for example, this is a measurement done at 2.8 Kelvin and around the magnet field up. The signal is just a step switch on. In fact, you start to see it grows quickly, reach a very pronounced peak, and then bang, come back down, and then come, go back go to some kind of a linear background. And this peak, if you measure at the increase the temperature, this peak quickly die down, and more around 10 Kelvin pretty much disappear. So, so as we can see, for different temperature, as long as you apply high enough field, they all collapse into a single curve, which was using fit by this purple line. Okay? And this fitting can tell us there's a magnetic response or electric field induced response in this material have two contributions. One is a linear, which is this intercept. The other one is some kind of non-linear contributions. The linear part, we do some try to estimate the size by comparing the signal of standard and any materials, and it's about all the magnitude larger than calculation from the first system. So it already can be something more than a simple theory, which only considering the magnitude contributions. And now let me try to explain why there's a this a giant enhancement of this MU from near this as you go to die in temperature. So this is actually Maxim's theory, okay, phenomenological theory, trying to understand why there's such a giant enhancements. So roughly speaking, from this low temperature, low field B2 phase to the so-called high field A2 phase, you can understand as a spin rotation transition to spin. All the moment is switched from 90 degrees from one to the other. Okay. So and there is so phenomenologically assume there's a so-called a critical point very close to real temperature. Okay. So if you at high temperature, when you, the transition is basically a smooth transition, so the spin smoothly rotate from O2 to A2. In other words, the free energy only have one minimum because of this coefficient. Is positive, the fourth order term is positive. But below the critical point, coefficient change sign to become negative, so you become basically a first order like transition behavior. Okay? And therefore, when you go down in temperature, basically you're marching toward this critical point, and therefore, the this kind of critical fluctuation enhance or softness of this spin rotation transition enhance the MEU response. Okay. So this so-called anomalous contribution according to the Maxim's terminology. So this is the so-called bare MEU response that I just described through the traversal. But because of the real spin rotation transition, you can think about this like around this near this critical point because it's very these two are very soft for the spin to rotate from B2 to A2 phase. So therefore, even small, when you have pressure of some field, when you apply electric field, you will favor the A2 phase, so the spin is all the moment toward the A2 phase, give you extra tending moment contribution. So that's the idea. Okay. So this is Maxim's theological model. It quoted described this giant enhancement of the energy from near this critical point. Okay. But now, this one issue here is that if this theory is correct, then if you put down below this critical point, then all this peak will disappear. You only get once a step. Right? Because it's first order, just a step. Unfortunately, here, 2.8 is pretty much the lowest temperature we can reach. Okay? we cannot really, for the urban magnetite, this critical point is roughly around 3 below 2 Kelvin, which is below the lowest temperature we can access. So, fortunately, for the related material, in terms of magnetite, this critical point is slightly higher temperature, about 4 Kelvin. So, you can, if you, you do perform similar measurement on this material, we should be able to go below the critical point and to check whether this giant peak disappears, becomes dead. So, this will be also did. So, this is in terms of magnetite, there's some technical issue. It's harder, relatively harder to notice. The earlier magnetite, we just use astral surface, very nice flat surface. This one, we have to polish surface, so the quality is not as good as the earlier magnetite case. But still, we can find, we can do the similar measurement. See the average one, it does have an enhancement. Okay? And if I plot the temperature dependence for different field dependent at different temperature, you see actually the behavior is different. Right? First, we do have this enhancement peak as we go down in temperature approaching critical point around 4 Kelvin or 3.5 Tesla. Okay? We go up, so it does have this enhanced, and then bang, below this critical point, then this pretty much disappears. So this behavior was described by Maxwell's theory. But what's different is that there's a below this point, there's another peak up here, a lower, slightly lower field. Okay. Well, if you compare this to erbium magnetite, in fact, we see actually there's also a similar peak at the lower field for erbium magnetite. Okay. So it looks like there's two contributors. One is coming from the manganese, softness of manganese moment as we approach the critical point, as we model. And there's another contribution which related to actually, according to Maxim, this is probably coming from the rare earth moment. So the rough idea is that the rare earth moment have basically behave like icing moment. So inside this ferroelectric environment, in your ferroelectric field, in principle, you will have electric field induced change of the G factor. Okay? So that change you can contribute to Van't Hoff coupling, and that can positively describe this kind of additional contribution. Okay. All right. Okay, maybe 2 minutes. So this is so far what I want to talk about for the magnetite. So in the last couple of minutes, I'd like to switch to ferrite, which is of interest on hexagonal ferrite. So hexagonal ferrite, the advantage, as already explained yesterday, you have this A2 bond state, so without planetary field, you already enter this magnetology phase. Okay? So Craig and Hannah have this idea is that if now the system forms this six-day vortex, now topological defect. Now, if they have a uniform magnetic moment, if the magnetic domain boundary does not couple to the threshold boundary, then you have the case like the hexagonal magnetite, the sign of the NE coupling determined by the threshold domain. On the other hand, if the magnetic boundary couples to the threshold domain boundary, then you can sort of apply electric field to change the threshold domain populations. Then you actually change the net moment sign of this material. So this is very nice. Unfortunately, for the thin film, so we got a film from Daryl Schlong's group. All the film he brought, so here we're going to show the location of ferrite from YZ, it's about 20 nanometers thick. They always single P domain, okay? No matter how you grow the sample, they always single P domain. So therefore, the P is a fix. Then in order to see magnetic domain, we have to induce magnetic domain. Okay? So the question is, can we see the magnetic domain? Okay, so that's the right step. This material has a very tiny guiding moment, about 0.02 millimeter. Okay, so which is much, much smaller than typical ferromagnet. Well, for this module, we actually can successfully see the magnetic domain, repair magnetic domain. Okay. So I'm showing here just an example. This is zero field cool state. This is this random up and down domain. And if you apply magnetic field, it's hard to read, but it's a half Tesla and then 2.5 Tesla. You can see as you apply magnetic field, the anti-parallel domain starts to shrink, the parallel domain expands, and then becomes single domain state. That's an effect, but otherwise it's single domain state. Okay, so it will go up in this curve and then come back. And when in the zero field or even minus 2 Tesla, it's still a single domain state, indicating it's very hard magnet. And then as you reach the corrosive field, then the anti-parallel domain starts, the reverse domain starts to nucleate and then propagate and etc. So you can sort of use MFM to construct this MH loop. Which agree nicely with spin meshes. Okay? We can also go low temperature, which is slightly more square-ish loop. Okay? The corrosive field is slightly higher. So now you can use magnetic field to induce this kind of domain, or either put up from a zero field or a magnetic field at the corrosive field, you can stabilize this two different magnetic domain in the sample. And unfortunately, when we try to apply electric field, don't forget the thin film, so we have to apply electric field through the substrate. The substrate, we thin it down to 100 micron, so applying basically 400 volt, still we couldn't resolve any signal. So the ME signal is below our noise levels order of 8 picosecond per meter in this case. So this is considered as theory. In theory, this ME response again smaller than 1 picosecond per meter. So we cannot detect anything. On the other hand, when we do the temperature measurement, we can show that we have a very good magnetic sensitivity. We can resolve this.